Welcome to our lecture on deep learning systems. As a clarification, this lecture only talks about deep learning systems in the end. We will look at one open source deep learning system, Apache MXNet. But this lecture is mostly about the history of systems and the development that led to the emergence of the modern deep learning systems like MXNet, TensorFlow, or PyTorch. So we've learned how to do machine learning on MapReduce, and we've also learned some of the performance problems that we had there, like the problem with iterations. And in this lecture, we're going to look at a couple of different system architectures, most importantly parameter servers, that kind of were hybrids between MapReduce systems and the systems that we have nowadays. And I hope afterwards you have some idea of the kind of how this development happened in the last years. So we're going to start with this parameter server architecture, and in particular with one important paper that popularized this architecture called Scaling Distributed Machine Learning with the Parameter Server from 2014. That is kind of the reference paper for these machine learning systems, and there's a lot of research nowadays. And the first author is Mu Li, who's now a principal scientist at Amazon and leads many of their machine learning efforts in AWS. And also Alex Smola, who is a very famous machine learning researcher who pushed this architecture. So the motivation for parameter servers came from machine learning researchers, mostly in industry where you have large data sets, trying to train bigger and bigger models. Many machine learning problems are too big for a single machine due to the growth of the data and the number of model parameters. And then you can go to systems like MapReduce and Spark. But what we've seen in the course of this lecture is that these systems were not really designed to be machine learning systems. MapReduce and Hadoop were initially designed for doing web-scale data processing for search engine use cases. And the system like Spark is more designed as a general scalable data processing platform, but not necessarily with a machine learning focus. There are many problems with these systems, especially if you go to very large data sets and very large models. So if you remember from our machine learning on MapReduce lecture, there we talked about batch gradient descent, a general algorithm to solve a large number of machine learning problems. And there I told you that we need to take the model and send it to each machine so that the machine can compute the gradients of the loss functions on certain partitions of the data. And then we need to update the model and send it back. And that is a computational pattern that you find very often in machine learning workloads. And it's something that's not very well supported by MapReduce. So you have to do, it's in some sense, it's like a broadcast join that we had to implement, where you always have to broadcast this object. And it's not something that's really in the nicely in the system design. So parameter servers try to tackle exactly this problem, like such workloads. And parameter servers are an architecture that is really designed for large-scale machine learning. So it's not designed to do anything else. And the key idea is that we have two groups of machines in our cluster, and you will see more details about this. And we partition both the training data and the model parameter over the machines in this cluster. And as I already said, the system design for the distributed execution of machine learning algorithms is very challenging because, as I said, there's these high communication costs for data and model sharing. And then there's also delays introduced by so-called synchronization barriers. So that means if you do this pattern that you replicate the model to a large number of machines, they recompute gradients and send them back, then if you do this synchronously, you always have to wait for the slowest machine, and that can really slow your system down. And both Spark and MapReduce are built as synchronous systems. So a map job is parallelized, but it's always synchronously executed. So you always wait until all the map and reduce tasks have finished. And you can, of course, build more more efficient, but also more complicated system if you try to introduce some asynchronicity there. So let's look at the big picture for parameter servers. So as I said, we have two groups of machines in the class, in the cluster where our parameter server runs. And there is one group which is called the server group, which consists of server node. And this group of machines is responsible for managing the actual model parameters of our machine learning workload. And then we have a worker group with worker nodes, which do the actual training and mostly the gradient computation. And in some sense, this is a third generation system. So I called MapReduce and Hadoop the first generation. And then I told you that Spark and Flink introduced a lot of knowledge and techniques from the from database research to build second generation systems. And in some senses, parameter server is a third generation system that evolved from them. So the first parameter servers were implemented as variants of Spark and Hadoop. And it's really a specialized system that's built for a particular workload for machine learning. And the key features are an efficient communication. So you have an asynchronous communication model, where you don't have to necessarily always wait for the slowest machine. Parameter servers also introduce flexible consistency models. So that means that in normal workloads, if you do general data processing, you always want to compute the exact result, especially if you do something like, I don't know, you work with financial transactions or things like that. But it turns out that in machine learning, because you use randomized algorithms, you use very robust optimization methods, that in many cases, you can relax the consistency of the computation a little bit. So you can update one thing more often. You can have certain versions of intermediate results that are a little bit stale. And empirically, it turns out that many machine learning algorithms are robust against this. And then you can trade off some consistency for a much faster convergence, for example, and for a system performance. And of course, in the parameter server architecture, we also want the functionality and the properties that we always want in scalable systems. So we want to have elastic scalability. So we want to be able to add new machines to our cluster without having to restart the system. And we also want fault tolerance and durability so that machines can fail and our system still continues to work. And we want some ease of use. But to be honest, in these parameter servers, you get this ease of use because they are tailored for a certain set of algorithms. So if you run these algorithms there, then it's kind of easy, but these systems are not designed to run anything else. So the the general example that we will use is similar to when we discuss batch gradient descent. So the generic example is empirical risk minimization. So we have a set of training data points XY, corresponding labels YI, a regularization function, and our model parameters W. And if the label is categorical, then this is a classification problem. Trying to predict a certain class, for examples. If the label is continuous, then this is a regression problem. And we assume that our loss function, similar to what to batch gradient descent, that our loss function can be expressed as the sum of the loss over the individual data points. So as I said, this subsumes many classification and regression problems. And then typically you would do something like batch gradient descent. And in parameter servers, a general algorithm for learning such models is used, which is called distributed subgradient descent, which is basically a variant of batch gradient descent. And the algorithm is shown here. And it's similar to how we would implement batch gradient descent in MapReduce. So we have servers that have our model parameters W, and we have the workers that compute the gradients of the loss function. So in the beginning, we assume the workers have the current version of the model. So what they do is and each worker has a partition of the training data. So they take the model and the partition of the training data. And then in the first step, they compute the corresponding gradients. They can already pre-aggregate them. And then in the second step, they push these gradients to the server. And the server can use these gradients to update the model. That's the third step here. And then in the fourth step, the workers pull the next version of the model. And then we repeat this process iteratively until convergence, or sometimes also just until a fixed number of iterations has been run. So this is similar to what we would do in MapReduce, but the main difference here is that you introduce asynchronous computation. So in MapReduce, the server would always wait until it has the data from all the models, from all the workers, then update the model, and then send the same model version to all the workers again. But in parameter servers, you have a lot of flexibility. So the server can, for example, do already some intermediate updates of the model, push it out. Some workers that might be faster can pull the model more often. For very sparse models, it might be the case that you don't need to all the parameters on all the worker machines. So there's a lot of flexibility here. And then people also, or the designers also, try to implement very, very efficient linear algebra operations here that are really tailored towards the machine learning workloads. So that's the general way in which we train models in parameter servers. And let's revisit this big picture. So we have the server group, and as I already said, the server group maintains the globally shared model parameters, and each server node has some partition of these parameters. These machines communicate with each other for replication, so they will again send some replicas of the model partitions to other machines, so that you could in theory lose a machine, and they can also redistribute the parameters if you want to up or downscale them. And the second group here are the workers. They store a partition of the training data to compute gradients or some statistics of the data. And the important thing is they only communicate with servers. So the only thing which they do is they either retrieve some of the shared model parameters or send updates for these model parameters. So this, you might already see, this is a very specialized architecture, and it's not as general as MapReduce. So it's really tailored towards a certain shape of machine learning workloads. And the shared model parameters are again represented as key value pairs here. Very often the key is a feature ID, and the weight is the current model weight for this feature. And these parameter servers also introduce additional semantics here. So they really have, as I already said, they have linear algebra built in. So they have support for operations such as additions and norm computations on sparse vectors, so that it's very easy, for example, to already pre-aggregate some gradient vectors before you push them out. And that's all, I also mentioned this for sparse models. You might not need the complete model parameters. You might only need a certain part of the parameters in order to compute updates. So these parameter servers also support so-called range push and pull. So you can so workers can only retrieve parts of the model to optimize the usage of the network bandwidth. And and there are also some really machine learning specific. There's machine learning specific functionality built in there. So for example, there are these server nodes, and I told you that we send the gradients there, and then the the server updates the model. Now, in the first versions of parameter servers, people didn't implement really special server systems. They just used a distributed cache, like for example Memcache or Redis, if you're familiar with them. And the problem there is that you cannot really do computations on the server side. So Memcache and Redis are, as far as I know, maybe it changed in the last years, are just data stores. So you can just store something in memory there and then retrieve it later. But for the algorithms run by parameter servers, it's really good if you can do aggregations and additions and model updates on the server. So parameter servers really have dedicated server components. And the main bottleneck in parameter servers is very often the actual network communication, because you always need to push and pull the model parameters. So if you want to improve performance and scale up these systems, then you have to figure out ways to reduce the network communication. And there are many things that have been researched there. One thing that's often used is compression techniques for both the model parameters and the gradients. And another technique that also works for some machine learning algorithms are so-called user-defined filters. So where you try to check how much the gradients would change your model, and you only send these gradient updates to the server if there's a significant change. And by that, it could be that you converge a little bit slower, but you save network traffic. So in the end, this trade-off might make sense and might really improve performance. So that was, on a very high level, the architecture of parameter servers. I think in their classical form, they're only used in research, but they're not really used in this form anymore nowadays. What happens is that modern deep learning systems like MXNet or TensorFlow have this parameter server functionality basically built in, and we will see how that looks like later. And in the next video, we will see a more concrete example of a parameter server for a particular problem. And it's some work that I did during an internship a couple of years ago when I was at Twitter.